Welcome back to the Island 54 Devlog. Every crafting survival game needs crafting materials. Well, today we will leave no stone unturned as we add our first resource to the game. In today's episode, we will add stones to the game, along with some basic UI for interaction. We'll start by modelling some basic stones, we'll scatter just a few of those stones into the world, and let the player perform actions on whatever they're pointing at. First up, I needed to model some stones to put into the world, which means it's time for Blender. My medium-term plan is to work towards allowing the player to craft a stone hand axe. So I started with a stone roughly the shape of an axe head that would fit someone's hand, maybe a bit bigger so it's easier for me to work with. I placed a sphere, then scaled various parts of it along the axes until I was happy with the general shape. I'm pretty sure I'm not doing this modelling the right way here. In a game, you want to keep the number of polygons as low as possible. Something like a stone could easily be represented with 6 polygons, with some good textures and normal maps. This one has heaps of polygons, but it's less work for me for now. I coloured it a stonish grey colour, saved it, then exported it as an FBX. It took a bit of trial and error to get the export settings right, since Blender and Unity use different coordinate systems, but I got there in the end. I also wanted a hammer stone so the player can nap the hand axe, so I made a second rounder stone that was a darker colour of grey to make it easier to tell apart, saved and exported that one too. With our 2 stone models done, we can tick that off in Trello, and we're done with Blender for the week. Next up, I wanted the player to be able to target stones in the world. To do that, I needed to create prefabs for the stones. So I dragged them onto my terrain, and then added some components I knew I was going to need, like a box collider and a rigid body. I dragged the stones back into my prefab folder, then created a simple component just to store what kind of object it was. I set that to stone for the prefabs, and set it to ground for the terrain. Rather than placing stones manually on the terrain, I created a script to scatter them for me. It takes a few basic parameters, like the prefab I want to scatter, number of instances, and where I want to scatter them. It then chooses a random location within that area, a rotation, and then instantiates that object there. It's worth noting there are plenty of stone assets in Unity's asset store, but just like with the character controller last week, I'm still working my way up the learning curve here, so I wanted to get a feel for the development loop. I created an empty object to hold the stone instances, attached my script twice, once for each kind of stone, and then tried it out. Looking at these, I can imagine a river with stones lining its bank. I actually had to resist the urge to go off on a tangent by working on more interesting terrain. Now it was time to write the actual targeting code. I created a canvas, then placed a reticule in its centre and a text box up in the top right corner. I created a new script to manage targeting of objects. How it works is pretty simple. It casts a ray from the centre of the camera out in the camera's forward direction and fires an event if what it intersects with changes. I also added a second script to listen on that event and update the UI to indicate what we're pointing at. Testing it out, that seemed to work pretty well, but I noticed that when you unlock the mouse cursor, it still uses the reticule, which doesn't feel entirely intuitive. So I changed the raycasting code to use the cursor location whenever it's unlocked, and changed the reticule to only show when the cursor is locked. I was pretty happy with that result. Next, I wanted to pop up a sort of a radial menu when the player tries to use an item. But I was worried that my UI code was about to start getting really complicated, with all these different components all referencing the input actions. So I replaced my UI state manager with a general input manager. It just manages which controls should be enabled, and fires off events to the other components. It was a bigger refactor than I expected, but I think it simplified my code a lot. With item targeting ticked off, it was time to move on to the menu implementation. I have a few ideas about how menus should work. The TLDR is that I want a radial menu, providing access to the different interactions available. I started by mocking up an example menu, meaning to use it for guidance on programmatically generating a pop-up, but I quickly realised I could just use the mock-up as the actual implementation for now. I loosely followed a model view presenter design pattern, where the presentation layer would accept a target object, generate a list of available actions, then reconfigure the view to allow those actions to be performed. So I got to work. The implementation was pretty hacky, and I'm pretty sure I'm leaking event subscribers all over the place, but it seemed to do the job. Pressing E on a targeted item triggers a pop-up menu. The player can select an item or close the menu with escape by clicking elsewhere on the scene. For completeness, I decided to implement the actual actions. Eating a stone just removes it from the world. Punching it displays a particle effect. Kicking it applies a force. Picking up stones is going to need a bit more work, as I need some sort of an inventory system, so that's going to have to wait for now. So with the ticket closed out, that pretty much wraps up this episode of the Island 54 Devlog. But before we finish up, I wanted to do a bit of housekeeping. First up, the incredibly literally named comment of the week. And for this week, it's David who says, "It's always cool to see people getting into game development, and it looks like you're doing pretty well so far. Can't wait to see where this goes." Thanks for the kind words, David. I'm also really excited to see where this goes. I have lots of ideas, and I feel I've now learnt enough about Unity that I can really start experimenting with them over the next few episodes. That said, I'm a bit undecided as to whether I'll start experimenting with some novel infantry ideas I have, or go on for a short tangent to get multiplayer working. Let me know in the comments if you have an opinion either way. Now, if you enjoyed this episode and want to support the series, please do leave a like and consider subscribing. If you didn't enjoy it, but watched the end anyway, be sure to leave a mean comment down below. Until next time, happy game developing!